And then in one last statement to Peter, to the Peter who had been so fiercely independent as a follower of Jesus, to the Peter who had prided himself on his very strength and independence, Jesus said in tender yet wise words, "Peter, when you were young, you could put on your belt and do whatever you wanted. But when you grow old, you will stretch out your hands and someone else will help you with your belt and take you places." In short, Jesus reminded Peter that we are all dependent as part of the human condition. And there is no shame in acknowledging that reality which we must live. Well, as I said at the beginning, this chapter is full of providential moments. Let me list them for you. Jesus provides his presence on the shoreline. Jesus provides guidance to the disciples about where to cast their net. Jesus provides a breakfast meal for the disciples before they ever reach the shore. Jesus provides an opportunity for reconciliation with Peter. And Jesus provides wisdom to Peter that in his old age, Peter will be dependent upon the provisions of others. This is a chapter about God's provision, about how God provides. And it gives us a good picture of what the providence of God can mean in our lives. Now, it's a far cry from what we usually think of when we think about providence. One popular way people in this country have talked about providence is to kind of whitewash our national history as simply one of God's providential blessings. You've heard this pop vision of history, I'm sure. America was supposedly a Christian nation, clearly established by God, and was given this land as belonging to us. The now largely discredited term manifest destiny was used to justify our claiming territory, killing native peoples who were already here and moving them into small corners of the country. Such pop thinking usually appeals to the founders in order to claim our divine origin and the providential purposes of God. But how does God's providence align with a nation established for slaves? A nation where African Americans were counted as 3/5 of a person. A nation where women, all women, could not vote and participate in governmental life. To want to embrace a kind of national providence, I think, is simply to want to create a good feeling for ourselves. It does not really have anything to do with the truth of our actual history. Manifest destiny, the idea that it was our destiny to do what we did as a nation, was a kind of secular providence claimed by earlier people in this country, and still in a popular way. Now, we can be grateful for many blessings in this country without holding a suspect theory of our providential origins. But even in our religious history as believers, popular notions of providence have been a distortion of our faith. There are some who say that providence means that God foreordains or predetermines all things. Everything that happens, happens because God intended it and directed it. God's providence becomes the same thing as the old Greek understanding of fate. It had to be this way and no other. Every event, every moment is under the direct control of God, predeterminedly so. Perhaps you've heard the one about the guy who was walking down the sidewalk and he was in deep thought about how God predetermines all things. He was so deep in thought that he did not see a low-hanging branch that that was right in front of him, which he hit with a loud thump on his head, after which he went down hard on the ground. Well, he came up, or he came to, rather. He got up, he dusted himself off, and he said to himself, "I'm glad I got that over with." To say that God predetermines all things is to say that God causes hurricanes and tornadoes, that God brings cancer and stillbirths, that God brought the Holocaust in Germany and 9/11 in America. To say that God providentially predetermines all things is to say that God brings tragedy and evil. And what does that imply about God's character? To that kind of God, most people would rightly say, "No, thank you." But the idea of providence we're given in this gospel passage is much different. Here, providence does not mean that God dictates or controls. It means that God provides. Let me mention three examples from this chapter, which, with each example showing that God provides an initiative, which then works in and with and through human response. First, Jesus provides the initiative for direction to the disciples on their catch of fish. But the catch is made and is hauled in with the effort and the labor of the disciples. Second, Jesus takes an initiative in providing a meal, in sharing with the disciples. But the meal takes on its fullness when the disciples also contribute their fish that they have caught. Third, Jesus provides initiative in seeking to reconcile Peter back into good relationship. But it only happens when Peter responds. In each instance, God chooses to provide, not apart from, but in partnership with the disciples. God's providence, though the initiative comes from God, is a shared venture. God provides resources with our efforts and our labor. God provides fellowship with our contributions. God provides reconciliation with our responses. The providence of God is not a dictatorship, it is a partnership. Now, to be sure, when God starts involving human beings in the process, it's going to get a little messy. But God, it seems, will not have it any other way. God chooses to provide in, with, and through us. This dramatically changes how we understand God's providence and our place in it. It is not some secret plan far away from our common lives, but rather, it is how God can guide and use and bless our everyday efforts. God's providence, for example, is at work in our families. I see many of you, parents, grandparents, aunts, uncles, sisters and brothers, sons and daughters. I see you and how God uses you to provide in the lives of your family. Not just material resources, but all the things that make for relationship and blessing. I see you and I give thanks. The providence of God is at work when our Sunday night prayer group meets to pray. When we go on a Habitat mission trip. When we give money in the offering which is used for church ministry. When we do a coffee hour, when we sing in the choir, when we get shoes for the children of Haiti, when we stop and listen to one another, when we welcome a little child, when we study the Bible, when we work on the church property, when the council meets, when we share words of encouragement and witness with one another, the providence of God is at work whenever and wherever we respond to God's guiding purposes. And we partner with God in such a way that God uses us. That is a prayer.